saying yes to God. As I look back over 50 years of ministry, I recall innumerable tests and times of crushing pain, but through it all, the Lord has proven faithful, loving, and totally true to all His promises. Once in a while, I will think about the fact that my father will pass on to be with Jesus. There will be a memorial service, and I already dread that because of the likelihood that I will be asked to say something I am a blubbering idiot in most scenarios anyway, so I can't imagine what will come out of my mouth. Hopefully it will sound something like, my dad was faithful to his wife and faithful to his calling. Then I will sit down as fast as I can, because there really isn't much more you can say about a person that's better than that. The word faithful is that context means that you kept your promises and followed through with what you said you were going to do. But that's not the only use of the word faithful we need to understand. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to God's people in Colossae, the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father. The simplicity here is wonderful. Paul uses his introduction to give them the most encouraging compliment one can give, calling them faithful. How are they faithful? Because they simply believed and trusted in God. We don't always get it perfectly right, but the pattern of our lives should show evidence of saying yes to God more often than not. We believe in Him, trust in Him, and put all our hopes in Him. At the end of our own lives, no other eulogy would be necessary than being remembered for putting our hope in Christ. The Bible is so clear about this. We can be faithful because Christ in us is faithful. May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your Holy Spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and He will do it. Lord, I want to be your faithful servant. I want to be known as devoted to you above all. You are faithful. Empower me to be faithful to you, for it is my heart's desire. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Life lived well. The Bible encourages you to fan the flame of faithfulness for a lifetime of following Jesus. Worry so often slows our steps, even for the most steadfast of Christians. But thanks to Christ and every comfort He speaks in Scripture, worry isn't something we have to worry about. Overcoming worry with faith. With prayer and patience, discipline, you can overcome every one of the world's cares, enjoying the fullness of a life lived well to God's glory. Hallelujah. What is your faith rooted in? Faith is the art of holding on to things your reason has once accepted in spite of your changing mood. it's fashionable to have faith and pretty much non-controversial. I have faith in my chair when I sit down in it. People have faith that things are going to get better. They have faith in higher powers, themselves, the economy, and depending on the results of the last election, faith in government. The concept of faith is warm and cozy, and daytime talk shows ooze happiness when discussing it. Having a hard time, just have faith. Yeah, faith is back in vogue. You are cool if you have it. The sticky part of faith is this: what is your faith rooted in? So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Faith has to be grounded in something. It's just goofy when we have this vague concept of faith and fuzzy feelings that have no basis in reality. Scripture teaches us that we are built up in Christ Jesus, the firm foundation. We have faith in Him because He is worthy of it. We are not to have faith in humanity that goes poorly. We have faith in Christ. Faith in Christ allows us to live in Him and be empowered for the mission by Him. He gives us that kind of faith when we ask it of Him. Jesus, you are the only one worthy of faith. I don't want to put my faith in false promises of man or temporary highs. I want you and the refuge you offer. Hallelujah, amen. Jesus, amen, hallelujah. What is faith? Faith is not trying to believe something regardless of the evidence. Faith is daring something regardless of the consequences. It may help us understand what faith is by occasionally breaking down who we are. This will help us avoid being taken captive through deception, as Paul warns. Our spiritual anatomy, you may recall, consists of a body, a soul, and a spirit. In the soul, we have our minds, our emotions, and our will. In our spirit, which is our true inner being, we have our life in Christ. So, we receive life in the spirit, we experience life in the soul, and we express life in the body. Unfortunately, we also have flesh, the desire to do things in our own strength, ingenuity, and skill. Indwelling sin develops in us too and encourages us to make poor choices. What then is faith? It's a decision of the will to act on what the mind believes is true. The mind reads something in Scripture, and in our spirit, the Holy Spirit says, yes, that's true. And we say, yes, that's true. And then in our will, we make a choice to step out in that truth. That step is faith. There is no power in faith itself. The power is found in the object of faith, Jesus Christ. So see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. Father, thank you for forming me and forging me into a special creation by your mighty hand. You have given me the capacity to have faith, and I want to have faith in the proper way. In your Son, Jesus Christ, teach my will to act on what is true as revealed by the Holy Spirit in the Scriptures. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. What is faith? I may not have gone where I intended to go, but I think I have ended up where I intended to be. If you were to say that we can continue to live by swallowing, I would say that's pretty much true. If we swallow food and water, we can sustain life. So swallowing is a conduit by which we live, but it's also a mechanism for death. Swallowing poison will go badly for you. So it's not really swallowing that lets us live. It's what we swallow that gives us life. For in Christ, all the fullness of deity lives is bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. Hallelujah. Amen. We have been given fullness in Christ. He is sufficient for us. In the same way that we don't exist by swallowing, we don't have faith in mere faith. Faith needs to be directed at Christ. He has all authority on heaven and earth. It is much more resorting to trust in Christ than it is to trust myself. I know just how incompetent I really am, and if you are honest, you probably feel the same way. Better to direct the focus away from ourselves to where it properly belongs. What are you swallowing today? What is the food and water that you are feeding your soul? Where is your faith directed? Are you trusting in people, things? Are you hoping that your faith will get you through? Father, you are the great King. Heaven is your throne and the earth is your footstool. My faith is in you and not in myself or anything else. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. What happens if I step outside of God's will? Many people think of God's will as a circus high wire that we have to walk on carefully or else risk falling off altogether. But is that accurate? And what do we do if we feel like we have slipped outside of God's will? There are two things to remember when it comes to God's will for your life. You will learn how God has a will and a plan for you, and how the Holy Spirit can empower you to find and follow His call. Then, when you realize that you have committed sin, very quick, confess and ask Jesus for forgiveness, and ask Jesus sends the Holy Spirit to guide you to the correct path. Hallelujah. Amen. Why faith in yourself is deadly? Faith is deliberate confidence in the character of God, whose ways you may not understand at the time. Everyone is a person of faith. faith. The reason to know this is because around the world, people use chairs. Stay with me a bit, this will make sense. If you were to sit down in a chair and it crumbled beneath you into a thousand pieces, I would not run up to you and say, "Ha, you don't have enough faith." What I would say instead is that the object of your faith was inadequate and you need to choose better next time. A lot of TV preachers will tell you that it's okay to have faith in faith, but the Apostle Paul would tell you to have faith in Jesus for salvation and faith in Jesus for sanctification. In the same way, you were saved by faith. Live in faith. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. There's proof as to whether or not we live by faith, and it's demonstrated by how we are walking with Christ. I, for one, know I cannot walk as Jesus did on my own. I must have faith in him to empower me to do so. Faith in myself is cute for the self-help section of the bookstore, but it will ultimately be my destruction. Praise his name that we have a firm foundation to put our faith in. Lord Jesus, give me clarity when it comes to what I put my faith in. May it only be you and nothing else. Help me tune out the false wisdom that surrounds me and hear the truth from your spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Depending on a completely dependable God. I think Superman should go on the Larry King show and announce that he would come back to life if people in all 50 states wanted him to. The definite comic book character is Superman. He has all of the amazing powers, but what makes him so intriguing to me is his disguise as Clark Kent. He would behave as Clark Kent as he went about normal human living, but when the need arose, he would tear off the suit and fly off in his blue spandex to save the day. We tend to think of Jesus in the same way. He walked around in his little human suit, and whenever he had to do human things like some carpentry, he was human Jesus. But then, when the supernatural was necessary, the buttons of his human suit popped off, revealing the big G for God on his chest. The super Jesus God would do all this amazing stuff, and then when that was all taken care of, he went back into his carpenter clothes, just like Superman putting on his tie and suit to become Clark Kent again. But that's not what we get from scripture. So Jesus said, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He and that I do nothing on my own but speak just what the Father has taught me." Jesus is fully God, yet He chose to live a life of complete dependency on the Father. He could have chosen to assume his God powers at any time, but he chose instead to remain wholly dependent on the Father. He was modeling complete faith and dependence on God. We are not called to live superhuman lives through our own hidden powers. We are designed to live in dependence on God. When we are weak, He is strong. When we are foolish, He is wise. When we don't know what to say, He gives us the words. We are the students and He is the teacher, telling us if we are willing to listen which way to go. Lord Jesus, thank you for showing me what it looks like to completely depend on the power of God. Reveal to me the ways that I try to be independent of you. Lead me into a more intimate and dependent relationship. I want to have a heart like yours was while you were on earth, one that is completely dependent on a completely dependable Father. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus, I depend on you. I depend on you. I cannot live without you. The life without you is completely disaster. I depend on you. Sometimes I need stay and use my mind, my heart, my action, but in the name of you, I depend on you, Jesus. Heavenly Father God, as the same as Jesus was dependent on you and trusted you, give the same relationship between me and Jesus as He has His relationship with you. Make it stronger, 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 and with love, happy, success, progress. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. What the who means for you, don't miss it. God's will is a what question, and it's also a who question. As we search the scriptures to discover what God's will is, we can't miss the loving character of whose will we're seeking. The Bible points you to the greatness of God Himself, His loving kindness, and the grace with which He works His will for you. Your unique calling. God has placed a personal call on your life that no one else can fulfill. You will learn how God has a will and a plan for you, and how the Holy Spirit empowers you to find and follow His call. Hallelujah. Amen. Why Christ's miracles are more than cool. A Christian is a perpetual miracle. Miracles are without question cool, but the fact that Jesus performed miracles was not reason enough to believe that He was God. Elijah performed many miracles, but he never once laid claim to his own deity. Christ Himself was adamant that His miracles were not just evidence of His deity, but of His dependence on the Father. But if I do them, even though you do not work, that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father. Hallelujah. Amen. He never downplayed the miracles he performed. He just wanted to make sure the people understood how and why he was doing them. Miracles do point to the fact that the Father was in him. He was in the Father, and he was dependent on the Father. Jesus didn't need to come to earth as a man just to do things in his own divine power. God had already been dealing with man in that matter. Things like giant pillars of fire and floods covering the earth come to mind. Jesus is fully God, but on earth he wanted to demonstrate physically to the people what it was like to so totally depend on the Father for everything that all else would fade. Lord Jesus, the miracles you performed were amazing. I believe. I know that they weren't just cheap magic tricks to dupe me into believing in you, but instead, tangible manifestation of your power when we depend on you completely. Strip away my independence, Lord. Thank you for showing me your might and what life can look like in dependence on the Father. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, amen. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father God, I depend on you in the name of Jesus. I depend on Jesus. Jesus is my Lord. He watches over my life anytime, any moment, any second, and keep me secure in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, amen. Jesus, don't leave me in that path you take me. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, amen.